unforgettable. That's what you are.
Unforgettable, though near or far.
Like a song of love that clings to me, how the thought of you does things to me. Never before has someone been more
unforgettable in every way.
And forevermore,
and forevermore,
that's how you'll stay. That's why, darling, it's incredible that someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too.
And welcome to this celebration of life for Susan Marie Foster. Whether you are worshiping with us here in the sanctuary or you are watching this live stream, thank you for being a part of this service, a service where we will affirm the beauty of life, the joy of life. We will celebrate Susan's life and all that brought her joy, and all the joy that she brought her friends and family and her community. So we come together to remember and to celebrate. Of course, part of the beauty of life is that love is so strong, so wonderful, and yet when we have to say goodbye to our loved ones, it can be so difficult. And so we come here also to grieve together, to surround John and Christy with our presence, our prayers, our words of sympathy. So we come to celebrate, we come to grieve and to support one another in our grief. And we also come, of course, to give thanks to God for Susan and to give thanks to God for our faith and our hope and a life everlasting. Let us begin with this call to worship. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, shall live, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the love that you have instilled in our hearts, for the peace that we find there, for the love that binds Susan's friends and family together this day, and the love that binded them to her. And so we pray that you would comfort us today with your presence. We give you thanks that you are here with us. We pray that as we reflect on Susan's life, help us to reflect on our own, to reach out even more strongly to you for the peace that you provide and the love that you give and the love that you call us to extend to others as we walk this path through life. Amen. Our first scripture reading today will be taken from the familiar Psalm, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his namesake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Here. I wanted to explain why I picked this song. My mom, as some of you know, was a beautiful singer. That was actually her first career, was she was a professional. So she was blessed with this talent of song. When I was little, she used to play The Sound of Music on loop. When I say played it on loop, I mean we'd put tape one in, then immediately put tape two in, and then rewind tape one, play it again, rewind tape two, play it again. And we would go through this about three times every day. So when I was little, I remembered knowing The Sound of Music by heart until finally the first tape broke, and then she would just play the second tape for a long time until she got another copy. So I wanted to play something for her. During the last few years of her life, I started playing guitar with her, and she would sing along. And I would always mutter, because she was always a better singer than I was, and she would tell me that I'm going too fast or too slow, of course. So I'm gonna go kind of slow for this one. Some of you might know this song. If you do, please sing it with me. It'll make me feel a little better. If not, it's okay. I'm gonna do two verses of it. And again, you don't have to sing if you don't want to, but thank you for not judging. Oh, the song is Edelweiss from The Sound of Music.
Edelweiss.
How I used to play it with her, mistakes and all. But thank you. And thank you guys for being here today. I'm going to be honest, I struggled writing anything down about my mom. The draft that I currently have was started at 2 a.m. this morning after I was up for a good portion of the night procrastinating. The major reason that I procrastinated was because every time I started it over this last week, it just never seemed to be enough. I didn't know how to condense 71 years into a short story. It's really hard for me to put into words what she meant to me and the legacy she left behind. So I'm going to do my best to tell you who my mom was. Unfortunately, many of you guys here did not get to know her before she was sick. Some of you did know her. You came over to our house and you met her as she went through her illness. But before my mom was sick, she was one of the funniest, most lively, Lisa Marie Foster was born July 20th, 1950 in Pennsylvania. She was the youngest of two girls, her sister Sherry, who she became extremely close to over the years, and her both moved with their parents to California when they were very young. Now, Grandpa Yuri went from job to job for a while, and that meant he moved a lot throughout California. So my mom kind of had a bit of a rough childhood when you think about it. I mean, imagine being a kid and moving all the time. It becomes really hard to make friends. So Sherry was her best friend. My cousin Elizabeth, I'm hoping, is streaming right now. This is for her. Unfortunately, my aunt died very young. And my mom never quite got over it. So one thing that gives me great comfort is knowing that right now, at least she's with Sherry again. And she's with her dad and her mom. But anyways, my mom had kind of a rough childhood, both at home and at school. She struggled with being teased and bullied. There were difficulties at home. But she never let me experience any of that. Growing up, my mom never told me that I was fat or ugly, things that she might have heard growing up. If I was bullied at school, I remember her once saying, "Who is it? Do I need to go beat someone up?" Now, of course, she was joking. She was completely nonviolent, but my mom wanted to make me feel better. I always think of it as hearing the stories of my family. It's hard to break that cycle of negativity, but my mom was so full of love that that's exactly what she did. And it wasn't easy for her. She led a very interesting life. After leaving her family, she went to college for a short time and tried to pursue a career in singing. Unfortunately, she says she blew her voice out singing for a rock group when she was much younger and never quite gained the confidence back to sing in public, though I wouldn't know any better because as far as I can remember, her voice was always phenomenal. She had a few jobs in life. She was interesting because even from a young age, I would hear these stories that she would tell and the stories my dad would tell and her friends would tell. And my mom always had stories that I never questioned, but now I think back on them and you've heard of big fish stories, like things that seem completely outrageous. And then you would think, oh, it's not real. But then you'd have like three people back them up. So I'm going to share a couple of big fish stories to you because this is the kind of person my mom was. She really was eccentric and special. One of my favorite ones was, I don't know how many of you guys have ever heard of Harry Mancini. He's a famous singer-songwriter, wrote Moon River. My mom was a big fan of him. She was staying in a hotel once. I think it was in Lake Tahoe. She found out Harry Mancini is there. So my mom has the guts to call the front desk. I don't know how she manipulated getting that man's number. But, of course, she called and had a conversation with Harry Mancini because she chose to. Just another example of crazy things my mom has done. this was one of my favorites. It's not a bad story, it's just kind of funny. She apparently was working for a very high bigwig in San Francisco. I think it was the fire marshal of the UN at the time. She was a secretary. And the story goes, this was a confession to me, that one time she was supposed to be trimming a famous autograph. And she's like, oh, it's some painter with a P. And I'm like, Picasso? And she's like, yes. It was a famous photo of this guy that she worked for with Picasso and his autograph. Well, in her zeal and not paying attention, my mom accidentally trimmed the autograph right off the photograph. So what does she do? She forges it. So somewhere on this planet is a forged Picasso by my mom. And I know she was embarrassed by that story, but I always thought it was really funny because I was like, well, yep, that's kind of, go for it, I guess. My mom was very independent when she was younger. It's hard to believe for some people who knew her later because she was so attached to me and my dad. But when she was younger, she tells me she never wanted to get married. In fact, she denied my dad 7 times. One time she threw the ring at him. Sorry, Dad. But the fact that he was able to get her says a lot about him. It wasn't him. It was just the fact that she didn't want to get married. So it changed after she was married, though. After she married my dad, he became her world. She followed him in the Navy. She was sad when she was gone, but she loved him. She stayed with him. And then they had a surprise in 1983. I wasn't expected, but as soon as I was born, my mom got seriously attached to me. Some of my friends growing up would know that she was the original helicopter parent. She wouldn't let me out of her sight. She worried about me constantly. And of course, me being my rebellious and independent self, who, you know, Mom, I got that from you. I resented it a little. Looking back, I completely understand why she was so overprotective. I was not the most safe of children. I was incredibly reckless. I almost got us kicked off of a bus because I was running up and down the aisle like a crazy person. I would run rampant on the parks. I have stories. She likes to tell this other story about how one time I saved my own life because I was choking on some spinach because I was just stuffing my face with all of it. And I was like, pulled it out. And she's like, you are lucky you saved your life right there. So I get it. I get why she was worried about me. It's a little reckless. Multiple concussions as a child. I think I missed a couple of days at school for those, Miss Lakey, just so you know.
but I get it now. Especially as a teacher, I completely understand why she was the way she was. This week I was talking to a friend who knew her, one of my friends who knew her when we were growing up, and this is one of the women that I was extremely close to, all the way from kindergarten to college and beyond. And she told me something that stuck. You know, she said, she's a mom now, and she said, she understands why my mom was the way she was. And how her mom commented, I never have to worry about you when you're over there. I know Sue is the safest person you can be with. That's true. My mom adopted all of my friends. The same love that she gave me, she gave to them. She's the one who taught me how to love. I like to think that that love that she had and demonstrated is how I reach out to the kids I teach. That comes from her. As I got older, I started to understand her more. There was the rebelliousness of my teenage years that I regret in hindsight. But when I entered young adulthood, my mom went from my mom to my best friend. We would hang out together. She would sit for hours as I showed her YouTube clips of various musicals from Broadway. She'd sing along with Whitney Houston and Barbra Streisand. She'd ask me to repeat them over and over and over again. One of my favorite memories is the trip we took to Disneyland after I got my first tutoring job. It was the first time that I felt happy and secure in a career, and I randomly decided that I had enough money saved that we would go on a road trip. And for 3 days, my mom and I drove down the 101 and stopped along the way anywhere we wanted to go. And it's one of the best memories I have of her. So honestly, when I say Disneyland is my happy place, that's one of the big reasons. When she started getting sick around 2013, there were signs. Things you don't realize are there, you look in hindsight. Things like getting lost on her way to the grocery store, or just forgetting things that are a little unusual for her to forget. It was hard. It was frustrating. They don't tell you, honestly, dementia does not look like it does in the movies. It really hit me, most of all, because my mom cared about me so much and loved me so much, and I know that I knew it was bad when she wrote, "Love, Susan," on my birthday card. That's when I knew. But even through that, I read once that somebody said, when somebody starts to lose their memories like that, they might not remember who you are, but they remember the feelings they have for you and the feelings they feel when you're with them. And she was always smiling in the end. Her last words to me were, "I love you." And I know it's probably because she kept hearing my dad and I say that to her all the time because we needed her to know how much we loved her. But I also know that she understood that it meant something good. In those last months, she would hold my hand, smile at me. And every time I think about the last days, I go back to that. And I know that her last memories, that's her legacy. Her legacy is love. Her legacy is through me now. She taught me how to love other people, how to love animals, how to care about other people, And that's what I want people to remember about her. So thank you.
Excuse me, I'm going to have to get my old man glasses. Actually, I don't need them yet. Well, for those who don't know me, I'm Susan's husband, John. I'm just going to tell you about what I know about my wife. How we met, and the wonderful times we had together, and the adventure. It was in the spring of 1978, when I was stationed in Mare Island, Vallejo, Valley Joe, or whatever. I was a host at a place called Port of Call out of Castro Valley, and I met my beautiful wife, Susan Urey, who was also a hostess there. We talked quite a few times, every Sunday, every weekend, actually, until eventually we fell in love. And as my daughter has pointed out, we were engaged 7 times. It seems her family, her mother and father, her father being an ex-sailor, didn't approve of her marrying a sailor. Didn't think the wedding would last. Well, it did. So on October 13th, 1979, my wife and I, in a small service, was married. Well, after the marriage, I went back to my ship and she stayed in Northern California and joined me in 1980. And I was awaiting orders to go to EOD. And unfortunately, I didn't get my orders, and the ship deployed with me on it. A week later, when I was pulled in Hawaii, I called her up. Now, this is before cell phones and the internet and all this stuff, so there was a nice long line, and you waited for your turn at the phone booth. So I get up there and I call her up and she first thing she asked me, did I get my orders yet? I said, no. She said, you got to go talk to your captain. Now the ship has 800 sailors. The captain doesn't know every one of us. And I was just an E4, low rank. So she goes, well, I said, I told her, the captain can't do anything about my orders. And she goes, well, who's his boss? And I said, Third Fleet Admiral. Yeah, remember what my daughter said about Mancini? Yeah, well, here we go. Well, pulled out, and we left to go to our next port, my darling, got ahead of myself here. I get a call about another week later to go visit the captain of the ship while we're deployed. So I report to his office, and in the meantime, he had turned around and looked at me and handed me a radio message. And the radio message stated that, per request by Mrs. Petty Officer Foster, Petty Officer Foster will be disembarked onto the nearest possible port to await orders. Signed, Third Fleet Admiral. Yeah, she called him. How she got through to him, I don't know either. So I waited in Okinawa for a week to get my orders to fly back, pick up my bride. And we traveled the country. went to Huntsville, Alabama for a short while, then up to Indian Head, Maryland, where I got orders to go to Hawaii after school. Well, being the cheap guy I am, being part Scottish, we drove cross country, and I had this Ford Ram pickup truck with a cab shell. And we took turns driving. I drove at night, she drove during the day. An intercom system between the cab and the back. And one time she pulled over to let the dog out to go to the bathroom. I woke up, looked, noticed we were in a rest stop, jumped out of the back of the truck, went to the rest stop. And when I came out, the truck was gone. She didn't check it. Not, I didn't tell her, she didn't check. Communication problem. So I waited a few minutes, thinking that she'd realize I wasn't there. Well, after a half hour, she didn't show back up. Again, no cell phones. So I called 911, got a hold of the police, and after the dispatch giggled, I explained the story. She dispatched a police officer to pull my wife over. Well, she's driving down the highway doing the speed limit. Trust me, that girl does the speed limit. And she turned around and saw these flashing lights on her, and she's talking to me on the intercom. Hey, I'm getting pulled over by police, and I don't know what I did wrong. Me not being there didn't answer. She thought I was asleep. The officer comes up, looks at her. She says, "Excuse me, ma'am, did you forget something?" She goes, "I don't think so." And she goes, "How about your husband?" And that's when she looked into the back end and noticed I wasn't there anymore. And this is what she tells me. She told me that the officer had to explain to her 3 times how to get back to me. She did, obviously. And we made it to Hawaii. And she didn't want to go to Hawaii because she had to fly to Hawaii, and she didn't want to live on an island. Well, we get to Hawaii, and she fell in love with Hawaii. And then my daughter was born. And once again, I was deployed. Well, I came back. I got orders to go to Fallon, Nevada. Spent a year or two in Fallon, and I decided I was going to get out of the Navy so I can raise a family outside the Navy. Ended up getting orders to New Jersey. And this is where my daughter's story about running up and down the aisle in the bus. My wife and daughter came out to visit me. They took a bus from Pennsylvania to Long Beach. This is where Chrissy was running up and down the aisle. He almost got kicked off the bus. excuse me. Anyway, so we got to Long Beach. One night we got a babysitter for my daughter because the ship was having a family get together type deal, a dance on the bow of the ship in New Jersey. And it was on the bow of the ship in New Jersey, my wife and I danced. Well, eventually I did get out of the Navy in 1986 and moved to California. A friend of mine said there's a lot of jobs in Sacramento, so I came up here. But since I already did 10 years in the Navy, I told my wife I'm going to join the Navy Reserves. She was not short of words to tell me why I'm not joining the Navy Reserves. So I convinced her to the National Guard, never gets deployed, I haven't been deployed since Korea. So I joined the National Guard. And she supported me in it. She went so far as to be what was called an ombudsman. That was the coordinator between the families and the Army. And she coordinated that, including a trip down to Camp Roberts for our training, where she brought the families by bus. made arrangements for the whole thing. So she brought my little daughter down there, who was dressed in BDUs, down there. Yeah, so we were going in, and I left my daughter with the troops. Trust these guys, really. Mm-hmm. And went into a briefing with the families, which we came out. And one of the guys goes, "Hey, Lieutenant," and I looked over, and there's my daughter laying behind an M60 machine gun pointed at us. Not loaded, by the way, just be safe. It was just kind of a joke these guys were pulling on. And my wife was not too keen on that idea. But she didn't say it out loud then. She told me later in private. The things that we went through, the love that I had for the woman and the love she had for me. I do believe you did love me, huh? Anyways, she did. Was extraordinary. And I was, and the whole thing in life with us was I was going to spend my retirement years traveling around. And yes, you may not sound it, but she did like traveling. She did like seeing the world. She didn't like flying, but she did like going around, seeing new things, getting new experiences. And I miss that about her. I tried to do 41 years, 42 including that time we knew each other. And it was not that, to condense it down, there was so many things. Looking for the Christmas trees, her going out trick-or-treating with my daughter, both of them dressed up. Her support of me, no matter what stupid idea I had. The motorcycle trip that we took from San Diego to San Francisco. Big mistake, she never rode back on a motorcycle again after that. But she was always, almost always, there for me. She was my anchor. Of course, she's trying to fill that spot right now so I don't spend all my money. But she was my anchor. And I probably never meet anybody else like her again. The scriptures you're hearing today were some of the ones we... My wife had a habit of outlining, underlining, and highlighting everything in the Bible. And we've got like 10 Bibles in the house now with highlights under them. So my daughter and I went through them and found the ones that we knew were very special to her. And this scripture was special to her. It's out of Ephesians 2, 4 through 10. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loves us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seat us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved with faith. This is not your own doing. It is a gift of God. Not a result of works, so no one can boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared before that we should walk in with them. Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, giver of life, guider throughout our lives, the one who sustains us and nourishes us in life, we give you thanks for Susan, loving companion to John, loving parent, nurturer to Christy, loving friend to many, assertive, musical, life-loving. We give you thanks for her spirit. We pray that as we journey this life, that we would recognize the loved ones that are in us, that have gone on before us, but whose imprint is deep within us and has formed us. And we give you thanks for the way that Susan has formed all those that she loved in her life. We pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Sometimes we make it.
Susan, child of earth, child of heaven, may the God who formed you in the waters of your mother's womb and called you in the waters of your baptism and promised the waters of the flood would not overwhelm you, now receive you into an eternal embrace and gather you with the company of saints who, having lived and died in faith, now live eternally in God's presence. Amen. Please stand in body or in spirit for our benediction today. Now the peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And friend, because Ashley is going to lead us in this.
That you and decided to create a dream come true. So this purple moon dust in your hair and gold starlight in your eyes are blue. That is why all the girls do follow.
To sing about it.
goodbye.
Goodbye.